Hello, witches, and welcome back to Activist Witch, where we discuss witchcraft and activism. You can call me Isha, my pronouns are she, they. And in this video, we're literally going to talk about why, if you practice witchcraft, really you're doing activism, or you should. This video is part of Witches for Palestine, and if there is one takeaway for you to take away, is actually go watch the full Q&A video by Sammie and Sabrin, who are two amazingly generous Palestinian people who sat down for almost 4 hours answering all the questions that were sent to them. In point of fact, there is also going to be a GoFundMe now. You find the link down in the description below, along with this neat trick. When you do a £5 donation or more on the GoFundMe, if you send us a screenshot of your donation at witchesforpalestine@gmail.com, you enter a prize draw. Prizes have been kindly donated by some of your favorite witchy content creators. You find the full list down in the description below. So if you would like to help Palestinian people and also get into the chance of getting prizes that are truly incredibly valuable, you can go to GoFundMe, and if you'd like to enter the prize draw, send us a screenshot and that is what will enter you in the prize draw. If you want to help and just support medical aid for Palestinians and not enter the prize draw, completely fine. You just do your donations, and actually thank you so much. The first thing that I want to get out of the way is what does witchcraft have to do with activism? Because it's a question that here and there I've been asked, despite the fact that thankfully there are over 30 witchy content creators that have got in touch to participate in Witches for Palestine. So they kind of understand that those two things are related. But very quickly, my view of witchcraft, and society's, by the way, view of witchcraft, is that of a minoritized, marginalized group. You're freaks if you're here. That's what society thinks of you. That naturally marginalizes you and makes you less valuable to society. Being part of a minoritized, marginalized community makes your existence activism, whether you embrace it or not. And then, by all means, there are branches of witchcraft that decided to do what white feminism has done. And what has white feminism done? Again, very briefly, the idea of white feminism was, cis white hat men oppress me. What I want is being on their same level, which also means I want someone lower than me to oppress. So every time that you hear witches focused on their womb and their bleeding and all their biological factors that are intrinsic to them, is just a very problematic way in which they have decided, can I find something intrinsic in which to oppress other people and tell them that they're less than me if they don't have these qualities which I have not worked for? That, in a nutshell, is the part of TERFs in witchcraft, which we don't like, and you're actually a f***ing. Since we are mentioning all this feminist intersectional stuff, let me also bring to the forefront the concept of tokenism, because I know that a lot of content creators and people in general involved in this project are white. And what I didn't realize is that part of the goodness of white people in progressive circles is having a lot of white guilt, because they realize their intrinsic privilege. As I mentioned before, privilege is not a bad word. Privilege is not a f***. As I said before, privilege is not a bad word. It's not something to be ashamed of, as long as you are aware of it and you put it to the service of those who don't. In this specific case, all these people have put their platforms to the service to amplify Palestinian voices. Something people get stuck on when something like this happens is, oh my God, is it tokenism? And if it is, of course I don't want to do it. In very brief, the point of what is tokenism versus what isn't when a white context platforms voices that are from marginalized communities is about the centering.
Yeah, one big thing that I've been like very, very kind of adamant on is like, if you're going to have like any kind of body that is doing panels, that is doing events, that is doing like awareness work or like action, make sure that you have Palestinians at the center of it as well. It's like, it is an important thing that, like, for example, if you have a panel of 5 people speaking about Palestine and none of them are Palestinians,
that's there is a problem.
Yeah, that's an issue.
There is definitely a problem. Yeah,
you need to make sure that you're highlighting those voices, you are giving them the spaces that they need.
Yeah, yeah. And also, and deserve. Yes, the right. Other way around, another problem is like that you seek Palestinian voices that already fit the narrative, like the poor abused women is one of the favorite one in the UK, and it's like that it's very damaging, very very damaging.
Using queer people to justify pinkwashing.
Yes,
we don't like that.
Yes, yeah. Or Christianity.
Yeah,
you know, Christian Palestinians as abused by Muslim Palestinians. Like what?
And erasing Christian Palestinian communities as well, because they are prominent in our communities.
Yeah, so. I'm a Christian Palestinian, but I mean, I'm an atheist Palestinian. So there you go. We exist as well.
I'm a practicing ex-Muslim, so
there you go. We are quite strange here.
And that's why it's important, and you will see throughout the entire video, we're gonna take direct quotes from Sabrin and Sammy and highlight, and hopefully you will go watch their entire full video, because I'm redundant here. That is the point. An example of tokenism that actually I've seen happen recently instead, if you want to get an idea, was a certain group of people that had this intention of doing an event in support of Palestinian people. They also happened to be all white. They asked me for advice, and I told them, I think you should invite Palestinian people. Their answer was, but actually we don't want to use them as tokens, so no, we'll just do it amongst us white people raising funds. That doesn't work. The idea that that is tokenism, therefore you don't center their voices at all, problematic. There is a difference between centering and crediting even, and just having someone present, stand in a corner because you can say they were here. I am not gonna mention a queer If you want a literal example of tokenism though, there's a recent play that I have seen that claimed to include people of color. This play was by, for, and written and performed by two cis gay men. The two people of color were on stage, sitting on the side, watching the play just like the audience would. But I am very, very positive that when they went to ask for funding, they said, we are inclusive, see, we have people of color, that is tokenism, don't fucking do that. Why are we doing this at all? Because usually ignorance is what fosters hatred, and you cure ignorance with education. For that purposes, knowing that there are not enough books that I personally could read that would tell me exactly what the story of Palestine is and what the story of current Palestinian people and what they're going through is, I was lucky enough that in my personal friend circle, there was a person like Sammy. Sammy is a lovely personal friend. We've been friends for over a year now. Sabrin, I had the luck to see at an event in support of Palestine here in Cardiff, and Sammy met them too there. And so the idea was, let's bring these voices together to answer questions of people out there. Why is this necessary at all? And to that I'll bring my own ignorance. There is so very little that I knew about the Palestinian situation and that I understood about the Palestinian situation before 6 months ago. What I remember seeing from TV news at most conceded that it was a complicated situation, and it made it sound that both Israel and Palestinian people had different rights to the same land, and so really they're both a bit right, they're both a bit wrong. That is absolutely not the case as soon as you scrape the surface. But it's not made easy at all to scrape the surface, because the entire media of US and UK have a vested interest in taking the side of Israel. So if you've only been exposed to mainstream media, and even if you are in relatively progressive circles, you might not have an actual idea of what happened there. And it's blood-chilling to realize. And what is more blood-chilling is to realize that Palestinian people have been saying the same things for 75 years. Arguably, for 107 years, it's the Balfour Declaration. Their voices are never allowed to get properly to mainstream, because the mainstream agenda is different. The mainstream agenda of the West, of the civilized West. Basically, the US and the UK wanted their cake and eat it too. And actually, I'll leave Sammy and Sabrin to explain why in a very quick timeline and why the Balfour Declaration was so fucked up.
When there was World War I, And the Palestinian actually helped the British and the French fights against the Ottoman Empire. They did so with the promise of independency. And then the Balfour Declaration, that by the way, it's a declaration in 1917, where the British Empire promised to the Zionists a Zionist state in Palestine. On which ground, on which authority? That it's completely colonial mentality, where you bypass completely the indigenous people and their needs and their rights of self-determination.
The thing is that they knew it at the time as well. Like, they knew that they were in the wrong. Like,
yes.
It's kind of like the fact that they knew already that it was the wrong thing to do and that they had no right to do so, which is why it took so long from that declaration to establish the Israeli state.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also the other things that people need to take into consideration. That UN partition on 1947, first of all, gave 55% of the land to the one-third minority of the population, one. And then what was given in that territory were some of the major cities that had high Arab population. What were they supposed to do? And also they give almost all the sea line and almost all the agricultural land. So they literally took away from the Palestinians all their richness, all their ability to build their economies and their industry and their agricultural economy.
This brings us to the point about informed decision. And Sammie had an amazing point about how history is written by the winners. And as much as they were absolutely shocked by the level of ignorance of their friends in the UK, me included, I'm one of those. I'm one of those ignorant. They were like, how do you not know? What do you study? What did you hear?
I've had friends here in the UK that have said to me, I've never known anything about this. And I kind of like had to do a double take because I was like, how do you not?
Yeah.
But then I kind of understood that you guys learned something different in history class.
Yep.
And that's where it became important to talk about it more and raise awareness, because it's like there are people who have actually never heard about what's happening in Palestine, and they need to know. People just need to know so that they can make their own informed decisions.
Yeah. And actually on Saturday we were at the march, and there was someone holding a picture of one of the kids, of the Palestinian child who died of starvation. And there were a group of teenagers that were just, you know, messing about around town, and they were with their bicycles, and they came across the march. They stopped because they were curious about what was happening. And I saw one of the guys looking, one of these young teenagers, looking at the pictures of the starving kids and literally do that with their hands in front of their mouth and with their eyes big. Now I'm telling you, if the only thing that that march on Saturday achieved was for that teenager to be shocked into something and question it and maybe go home and start looking at it, that was a massive win.
Mm-hmm. Also, like, I remember through some of the actions that we've had going back home, and on my way home I would be like hearing people talk about it, and I don't even know if it's positive or negative or in what context they're talking about it, because I'm just passing them by as they are walking past me. But it is making a difference in that it does get people to talk about it more and discuss it more and understand where their understanding stops and where they need to do more research and more information, like building and diving as well. So keep going to those protests.
Yeah.
And when you start to look into it, you realize that unless you have a very high level of literacy, a knowledge, an ability to know where to go and educate yourself, it's absolutely not obvious to get out of the general message that, again, the US and UK have an interest in continuing, that it's, Israel needs to exist, because if it doesn't, then it comes out that actually the entire reason why we supported it was just so that we could get rid of Jewish people in our own countries ourselves. And no, we want to pass for progressive here. The simple fact that during World War I, the British promised the land of Palestine to Palestinians if they help them fight the Ottoman Empire, at the same time, the Jewish people, to create a state of Israel, goes to show that they were like, eventually one of these will die, and so I don't actually have to keep my entire promise, which is impossible to keep anyway. And more importantly, as Sabrin says, who has the authority to take a land away from the people who are indigenous to it and decide who to give it to? I thought we all agreed by now that colonialism was wrong, no?
I wanted to add like a very, very brief like timeline as well. In the 1800s, what's it called? Socialist Zionism? Is that what they called it back in the day?
Yeah.
Yeah, was formed. And it was, the idea of it was basically to find a nation for the Jewish people that was not specified at the time. Like, they did not specify at the time that it would be in Palestine. I think they looked into different areas.
Yeah, in Africa.
In Africa as well, Rwanda. Yeah, and then there was this proclamation made that they would be giving them a land without a people for a people without a land, which at that point someone even like mentioned, actually, like, the place that you've chosen, Palestine, does have people living in it, so how would you propose that we do this? After that, when World War II happened and started, and there were some very anti-Semitic, and I think this is a very important part of the history, is that when anti-Semitism was on the rise in Europe, a lot of Jewish people were either forced or coerced to move to Palestine because they were given, like, they were accepted as refugees there.
The Balfour Declaration and a lot of the Zionist movements and European Zionists were not doing that in the interest of Jewish people. Actually, mm-hmm. there was a lot of anti-Semitism behind the Balfour Declaration. Yeah. It was the idea that if you could move Jewish exactly. away from Europe, you would get rid of them. Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Actually, that is very anti-Semitic to start with.
Yeah, the whole thing kind of started with anti-Semitism as well, as like wanting to get rid of the unwanted
yes.
people in Europe. And where in Palestine, they were not unwanted, they were actually welcome. They were welcomed yeah. and treated as part of the people that were already there. And this is also like in the telling of how we are told these stories from our elders and our grandparents. We are told that we welcomed them into our homes. Like, we didn't even build separate homes for them. We welcomed them into our homes.
I think that's a very important point because, again, for how you hear it in the media, the two-state solution would be the more reasonable solution. And then you kind of understand the point of these houses being expropriated, people made to run away to neighboring countries, and their own house being just occupied and inhabited by settlers now, and there's nothing that they can do. And it's just right. And actually, let's put it on paper and make it legal. Of course not.
So if someone come to your country or to your house illegally and takes it over, and then it tells you, okay, you can stay here, but you take the first floor and I take the ground floor, would you have accepted it? It's like, is the premises that was wrong? It feels like, oh, the Palestinian refused such a reasonable mm-hmm. partition. The partition was not reasonable in the first place. No one had the authority to divide that piece of land and just say, okay, now this is Israel. That it was a highly colonial, global north, western types of policy, that you could just think that you can go into an indigenous land, divide it, and then the indigenous people have just to accept it. And if they don't, they are violent and unreasonable. Would be accepting the Nakba,
yeah.
would be accepting losing your territory.
Never coming back to your
home. Never going
well.
Back to your home. Yeah. You know, you have to understand that people literally have and still have
the
keys of their homes.
Growing up, like, even we didn't have the keys, but we had like a picture of my grandpa's home in Palestine, and that is something that he held on to for as long as like he was, like, he's still alive, but he still holds on to that photo with the hope to go back. So that's yeah
some people in Jerusalem literally go on tours to go and see their grandparents' house that now are occupied, and they can see them. And they can't go in, and they actually, if they try to get close, they are shot at. So you have to understand that by creating an independent state on the land that was left to us after 1948 would be to renounce mm-hmm. to what was our house. Mm-hmm. It was our land, our orchards, our olive trees.
There is a beautiful point about the meaning of terrorism that Sammie made. that I think you need to watch.
How you contextualize the meaning of terrorist as well, because in the West, there's this quickness to say that anything that is Arab is angry or violent in the first place, or like that that people of other nations are violent for no reason. It's kind of a rhetoric that is kind of like a very Western way of looking at the world. And, you know, as an Arab, we grew up with the joke that, oh, you can't say bomb in the presence of an Arab or we'll find the police around us, because we are all kind of like, because of Islamophobia and a lot of things, we are all kind of like used to being referred to as terrorists.
We are profiled immediately.
We're profiled as terrorists. So with the quickness to jump to call any resistance effort a terrorist attack as well, as it's a very, we need to actually come to understand what we mean by terrorism and what context terrorism comes under as well.
Yes.
Armed resistance is not terrorism always, and like it's understanding also the role.
People think that that's an exaggeration. People will, you know, shake it off as in, it's a joke. Of course it's a joke. I still remember the one and only time that I went to the US and I have a very triple-barreled Arabic name and surname. I was the only one on my entire flight from Ireland to be called to the side room and kept there for half an hour. Everybody else just went through custom. I was held there. Everything that I owned was opened. I was there to study. I was there to study and I had all the tickets, all the proofs, and it was never enough because my name was Arabic. So the profiling and the way that we are treated is real. And it's justified by the idea, oh, you could be one of them. Incredibly, domestic terrorism, white supremacy terrorism in America, it's recognized to be the first threat to the country. And yet, the foreign Arab is what we have established is worse. And the issue with a country deciding arbitrarily what they account for terrorism and what you as the populace agrees to is that the moment that that is agreed upon, that those are the people that deserve the worst. They deserve torture. They deserve death. They deserve to be dismembered. They don't deserve humanity. The moment that you concede to your country that anyone under any label deserves that and you agree with that, the country will find a way to extend that definition so that it includes anyone that they consider inconvenient to have around. So be very, very, very careful what you ever agree for your country to do to the worst of people, because you might think it's the worst. A country, a government is not that honest. A government will find a way to add to that definition whoever they decide it's undesirable.
For me, what I also think is terrorism is when people will sit on a mountain and watch other people get bombed and call it like...
And cheers.
Yeah, and call it like the cinema. So for me, that is terrorism.
So, do you not acknowledge that Palestinian children are indoctrinating from birth to want to kill Jewish people?
I have never been indoctrinated, have you?
Like, no.
Am I left out?
If that's the case, we have been left out.
Yeah,
there you go.
No, so.
There is this beautiful poem by Rafif Ziadah called We Teach Life, Sir. Mm. I suggest to whoever asked that question to go and listen, because you can find it on YouTube.
What was your moment when something hit you, it got to you, and you understood what's happening in Palestine is not right? I can tell you the precise moment that it was for me. And it's because I saw something like Sammy describes. When you see the picture of people on the top of the mountain watching Gaza being bombed as if it's the cinema, as if it's something to cheer, there has been a dehumanization there. And the simple fact that Sammie and Sabrin have been asked the question, do you acknowledge that Palestinian children are taught from birth to want to kill Israeli people. There's unpacking to do that they did. The thing that stood out to me from that was, wait a second, they're talking about indoctrination, but every person living in Israel has to do mandatory 2-3 years in the Israel defensive offensive force. So every single citizen of Israel has actually been trained as a soldier. Now, I don't know how much you know about the army, but there is a degree of brainwashing and literal indoctrination that you go through because you need to be able to follow orders and not to question them. The accusation of every single child in Palestine has been taught to hate, has been indoctrinated to kill, is exactly what actually happens to everyone that lives in Israel, and therefore the IDF for them is mandatory. When Jewish people refuse on the account of being objectors of conscience, they are imprisoned. So it's not a choice. And in a way, it's generous to say indoctrination through the army, which is true, because to a degree it takes away their agency. And these people decided awarely to sit on top of the mountain. These people decided awarely to start doing TikTok compilations where they draw monobrows and pretended that their children with monobrows depicted, so Arab, were now dead, were now losing teeth, started to mock the fact that they could open the water or flicker the lights on and off, because in Gaza they couldn't, because Israel had cut the power and the water. That is what did it to me, because there is a level of dehumanization there. There is a level of cruelty for cruelty's sake. There is an understanding that I cannot reach of what have you been told for 2 or 3 years while you were training as a soldier to defend your country, supposedly, that makes you justify every single Arab person needs to be killed. And on top of that, as if injury wasn't enough, the insult is, this is what actually awarely we do in Israel, but let me accuse them of doing it. And that is fucking me up. I don't know. I don't understand. How can you literally be part of, knowingly, awarely, they go proud of being part of the IDF reserves, every single Israeli person that has been part of it, and it's blowing my mind that then the accusation of no, but Palestinian children are actually indoctrinated. I don't know for you, it sure circuits my mind.
We are seeing every day that protesting on the streets in the US, UK, and etc., all over the world, it does achieve something and it does make a big difference. Like, I think a lot of the people who say that protesting on the streets of the US and UK specifically are saying this because they don't understand the UK and the US's complicity in everything that's happening.
We live in a society that is telling us that everything has to be obtained immediately. So if you protest today, changes has to happen tomorrow. Because that's capitalism, that's consumerist societies. My strong dream is that the way we protest and the way we are asked for change and the change we are trying to manifest and bring about is actually gonna go not only towards saving Palestinian people, but on also saving us as humanity and against capitalism. Mm-hmm. And one of those things is accepting that not everything is product, but it can just be a process. Mm-hmm. It can just be a movement.
In case it needs reiterating, no. What we have seen in the last 6 months is that protesting works, is that boycotting works. The level of information that you are getting now about Palestine is unprecedented. And the fact that it's getting to you, it means that all this stuff is working. I've seen myself, it's the first time that on the outskirts of mainstream media, we are getting proper voices understanding the position of Palestinian people as colonized indigenous people that are accused of everything they do to try and keep in their home. It's just mind-boggling when you start to understand the context. And that's why the contest has been kept away from mainstream media for so fucking long.
Is that people in Palestine watch our protests. They feel that kind of solidarity that we send in our protests, yeah. And they know that we're there fighting with them. I think for me, it's like one of those big things where I have started putting my Saturdays specifically aside for the protest because A, it's solidarity, B, it's fighting back, and C, it's a big part of my self-care as well.
Yeah, they are amazing place of love, mm-hmm. and healing and community healing and community making and meaning making. Mm-hmm. Yes, these protests have been depicted as something violent, mm-hmm. and aggressive. Like, I have been to the London ones, to the Cardiff ones, to the Bristol ones.
They are love marches.
They are love marches.
They are love marches. We are giving love to the people of Palestine and to each other in those moments.
100%.
Yeah. To me, it gives incredible hope to understand every protest that I have been for Palestine. Just as Sammie said, not only they are marches of love, but they understand that there is a bigger picture. And it's making me understand that for people to finally see and understand what's happening in Palestine and not accepting that their governments still decide to support the genocide means that there is a possibility of hope. It means that people are fed up with how the system is. And Palestine shouldn't be the canary in the pit. But I think it's what's happening. The global movement that it's happening around Palestine to try and save Gaza, well, now to try and rebuild Gaza, despite the lives that have been lost, and there's nothing to do for that. There's nothing to do for that. There's generations lost because settlers wanted a land that wasn't without people, and they decided to make it as such, and they have kept doing it with impunity. It's the impunity.
I'm still a strong believer of the international law, but it has been applied quite randomly and with a lot of double standards. Mm.
Because if the situation was reversed, like Sabrin said, under international law, Palestine has not been allowed to defend itself, but Israel, with that excuse, has got to make its own place in a land that they decided to occupy 75 years ago, despite the people that have been there before. And what shocked me as well was hearing Sammie saying there's the stories that our grandparents give us that they didn't even have to build new homes. We opened their homes to them. And then they just literally occupied their homes and displaced and killed 750,000 people during the Nakba 48. Is that mentality of I'm better, I'm superior, is the colonialist mentality. And now I start to understand, I had never heard the word colonialism associated with Palestinian situation before October 7. And I fancy myself being educated, being progressive. I have limits because, for example, because of my dyslexia, I very hardly can read, but I listen to a lot of things. I listen to the radio, I listen to podcasts, I watch video essays. And that still hadn't got to me before 6 months ago, despite the colonization having gone on well since actually before 1917, because Jewish people started to move to Palestine well before the Balfour Declaration, actually. Fun fact, do you want something related to witchcraft today? Okay. Do you know the infamous book Sex Magic, Advanced Sex Magic, translated by Maria Denaglowska? She was a Russian socialite that lost her status and had to leave Russia because she married a Jewish artist. After she had two children and she was living in Switzerland, her husband abandons her because he wants to go to the motherland. This is 1909, I think. And so he abandons her to go in a kibbutz in Palestine. So yeah, there. You wanted a witchcraft connection in case you haven't realized that witchcraft needs to be activism, because believe you me, society comes after you anyway. Well, there's your connection.
Also, there's like the idea of like Western idea. So when the West presents itself as an enemy to the Arab people or an enemy to the Palestinians within their policies and things like that, naturally anything that is perceived to be like coming from the West is going to be perceived as a threat to traditional values or something. And that is a very big barrier as well. It's like currently, because of the pinkwashing and propaganda, because of decades of it, we've reached a point now where queer people in our own communities are seen as outsiders. We're seen as like people who are influenced by ideas of the West. Whereas one of our like the big things that we are doing is like we're actually going like, no, we're just ourselves. We are who we are and we have a right to exist as well. Mm. Also, like if you talk about genocide and people who are being targeted and genocided, birth rates are going to be very important, and continuing that kind of like family structure is going to be very important to the society. So like when you talk about misunderstandings of queerness, then people will be like, oh, but then you can't have a family, you won't have babies, and then we're, you know, our people will stop existing. So that is seen as another kind of threat. There are many things to unpack when it comes to like queer rights in the Arab region and in Palestine. It all starts with getting rid of colonialism and decolonizing, and then we can start talking about how we can challenge our own people.
Yeah.
And those like kind of things that were born out of pinkwashing and trauma. Because as far as I'm concerned, like having done some Islamic studies and some historical studies, I'm not convinced that Muslims are inherently queerphobic. I'm not convinced that Arabs are. I am convinced that this is a result of colonization.
Mm. As queer people, I think we have been told, even without being Arab, which I am, we've been told since the beginning of this, every single thing that we say, doesn't matter the receipts, it doesn't matter the reasonability, the straw man that is straw at us is, what you say means nothing, because if you were in Palestine yourself, being queer, you would be killed. When I did the first video on Palestine, the very brief explanation, an example that I gave you of pinkwashing there, came from Sammie as well. Because my understanding was limited. Like, I have never been to Egypt because I have concerns. I have concerns. And I had never realized the problematics of the West cloaking itself in pinkwashing and using LGBT rights as one of their representative things. Because, of course, then, when all these people know about you is how you've tried to destroy their existence, while claiming that it's not as such, like, again, to add insult to injury. Everything you are and represent is wrong. The entire existence of basically the far right of the Middle East, not only of Palestine, not only Hamas, but the entire far right, fascist traditionalist, the Muslim Brotherhood, every single reactionary party and idea that exists in the Middle East exists because with the West going and keeping on doing damage, that is the only alternative presented. Those are the only people. Fascists are always the only people that stand up when there is a threat to the culture and to society. Because going back to what you know is something that you can sell easily to people. And I should know, because I was raised in Italy. Italy who hasn't learned, by the way, its lessons, because we still have fascists in government now. I'm closing this with what was also the ending of the Q&A, which, once again, I beg you to go and watch in full. If you don't have the time or ability or attention to read a book, please go listen to the story directly from Sammie and Sabrin. They have been so kind and gracious to answer questions that, how are they not mad that we still simply are that ignorant? And I understand on an individual level that a lot of our ignorance depends on, again, the media agenda and what we hear on the news. And that's very, very well selected. Why do we all know that it's a complicated situation and a two-state solution should be what we opt for? But likely none of us had heard of Rafif Ziada's poem. I'll link that in the video description as well. We are lucky to live at a time where information is harder, not impossible, but harder to censor. And I think what's been happening in the last 6 months is exactly that. Even with social media that I don't necessarily appreciate, like TikTok, the simple fact that videos from the phones directly of Palestinian people could be shared. And you know what? Even the disgusting stuff that the IDF, IOF actually, recorded themselves and felt free to share because they don't even consider people that they kill human enough to have the decency to be ashamed. So we know directly. This is the first time that we know and see directly. And we can make informed decisions. And we should be fucking mad that for 75 years, the plan of the West to support Israel because it was in their anti-Semitic interest to not have Jewish people in their countries anymore if there was a state of Israel, that is what has set the agenda for 75 fucking years. And most people have got to learn the actual story just in the last 6 months, while generations of Palestinian people have been living with the history on their shoulders if they were lucky enough to still survive. At the end of the day, I came up with this project because, in case you're wondering, full disclosure, I am part, as a volunteer, of Glitter itself. I am their education and training lead. And so as part of that education, I wanted to do this Q&A. And because this is my personal life and interest, and I already want to put together witchcraft and activism, seeing that there were so many other people in the witchcraft community that understood the intrinsic relation between witchcraft and activism to the point that realistically, whether you mean it or not, it's part of your existence every day. And that just made me understand, well, then maybe we can educate people from one side with a Q&A from Glitter, and we can amplify those voices if other witches want to share with their own audience a direct voice. Because we all want to do something, but we all don't know what to do. And well, I have these friends that I know personally hearing the story of Sammie without understanding at the time. All that I thought I knew was that they were from Jordania and they were an LGBT refugee here in the UK. And then one afternoon in late October, we were having tea together and they started to talk about how everyone from his generation has heard the same story from their grandparents about leaving Palestine, and I realized they were talking about the Nakba and I didn't know before. And history tries to be rewritten by the winners, but the silver lining of this age of communication directly is that we have been given the chance to hear directly. So this is the time to actually elevate those voices. So once again, I very, very strongly encourage you to go watch the full video. And if you have any economic availability, there's the link to the GoFundMe in the video description. If you do a donation and then you want to participate in the prize draw, do a screenshot of your donation, send it to witchesforpalestine@gmail.com. By the end of April, we will assign the prizes to all the people that have sent in the screenshot. So the donation alone is not an entry. You need to send this screenshot. Do you want to hear a funny story?
Or a not so funny story.
Do you want to hear a peculiar story? A few days ago, I did my first professional tarot readings at an event. And Sammie was there, along with other friends of mine. It was a queer night, very nice. I do recommend queer folklore. And by the middle of the night, I heard that a lot of people were coming because Sammie was telling them, no, you need to go. You need to go to her. You need to have your cards read, because they read mine and it was shocking. And I didn't remember. I read their tarot on the 16th of August of 2023. And apparently what I read to them, then I found a picture actually of the reading. I don't know why that day, the only picture that I have is that, but anyway. In that reading, I basically told them, you had to defend your position a lot, but I worry that more of this teaching and defending your knowledge will come. And if anything, you'll have to become some sort of social justice warrior. And Sammie apparently was like, well, I already sort of do that, which they do. They are part of an organization that helps refugee LGBT people. So it's, that was the 16th of August. So it was less than 2 months before October 7th. Sammie's been one of the, of course, most present, more active people that we have in Cardiff for this. Every single event, it doesn't matter how tired they are, it doesn't matter. They're just there, they're always there. I can't imagine the mind state, the physical state to do all these physical things, because there's a lot of protests that I can't personally go to, but they are always there. This is part of what I'm doing, actually, to make up for my lack of ability to do other things. So that's why I hope that we can raise with GoFundMe. That's why I hope that you go and listen to Sammie and Sabrin. But yeah, you wanted a witchcraft connection. Apparently there's that, and I didn't even remember it. But yeah, a couple of months before October 7, I told Sammie, oh, times are coming where you will have to defend your identity, your position a lot, and you'll have to become a bit of a social justice warrior. Yeah. Thank you for taking the time to watch. Go watch the full video on Glitter. There's a lot of white, cis, patriarchal, colonial system to be taken down.